Well, we've been in a series called DNA. Everybody say DNA. DNA. We've been talking about who we are as a church, who God has made us to be. And we actually got together as a team this year. We really prayed about it. We felt like the Lord really gave it to us. And we put together our vision and values as a church. A simple vision, which is helping people find and follow Jesus, followed with five values. And these really represent who we are as a church. DNA, if you look that term up, one of the phrases you'll come across, it says the molecule of heredity. In other words, it's something that's passed down to you from previous generations. Now, we believe this. We believe that when God created Inglewood Church, and we're almost 75 years old as a church, that he gave the church a DNA. The Bible calls the church the body of Christ. So just like your body has a DNA, the church has a DNA. And so instead of looking at and saying, well, who do we want to be? We just said, hey, man, let's trust who God has made us to be, right? And so our DNA is this. It is who we are, and it is who we inspire to be. And it's represented in our vision and values. Now, somebody the other day, they were talking to me. They said, Pastor, I'm so excited about this series. The only thing is, where's it going to be, you know, a year from now? You know, I know you're doing a series on it, but are we going to keep talking about this? And all I can tell you is this. We don't have any other plans. This is who we are. The way we're going to accomplish our vision, helping people find and follow Jesus, is by living out our values. And here's our prayer as a church. I pray that long after this series is done and you bought the t-shirt and everything else, listen, that you will begin to make our values your values. We pray that there'll be a day when you're accused of being a part of Inglewood Church that you can be arrested by DNA evidence. Amen? And in fact, we plan on celebrating every time we catch you living out one of our values. And so for those of you that maybe you haven't been a part of this or you've missed a week or two, let me just show you what they are. They're on cards and stuff out in the hallway. But our vision, helping people find and follow Jesus, and then read them with me. Everyone, come on, help me out, belongs before they believe. We are what? Better together. We listen to God and what? Do what he says. Our cause does what? It trumps our comfort. We talked about this last week. And now this week, our final value, our past does not define our what? Our future. Today we look at the final value and maybe the greatest value we have as a church. This value is a value of redemption and restoration, and it's a value that celebrates the great grace of our great Savior. Now, with all of our values, there's both an individual and a corporate application. In other words, the church isn't just a building with a bunch of people. The church is you as well. And so not only do we want to apply this to our church at large, but I want you to apply this individually. Because how many of you know, both collectively and individually, we all have a past? Anybody walk in here with quite a past? In fact, that is probably the understatement of the year. How many of you would like to have your past just kind of put on the big screen this morning? How many of you would run out crying? You know, absolutely. And so here's the thing. Listen, collectively we get together, and maybe my past is different than your past, but we all have a past. And we all stand before the Savior, broken and absolutely unworthy. Well, the great promise of the gospel is the transforming grace of Jesus that is greater than the totality of who you used to be. How many of you are here that you're used to be? Amen? You used to be. I used to be this and I used to be that. Why? Because we've been transformed by the grace of Christ. Now, Christ is greater than you are. He is greater than me. Now, I want you to say this with me. God knows it all. Come on, say it with me. God knows it all. God knows every intimate detail of your past. In fact, people that say, man, God would be embarrassed if he knew who I was. I mean, you know, God knows who you are. Amen? He knows every intimate detail of your past, all the shame, every little bitty part of it, all of it, and yet he ultimately chose to transform you and forgive you anyway. See, God knows about your dark past, and he has chosen to give you a bright future anyway. Our future in Christ, now listen, it begins, everybody look right here, it begins with the forgiveness of Christ. The seismic shift of who you were, now come on, this is basic, but I want you to grasp it today, to who you can be, begins with you acknowledging who he is, listen, and what he has done for you. The way everything begins to change is for you to acknowledge who Christ is and the way he has done so much on your behalf. Now listen, the past loses its grip on your future when you accept the undeserved forgiveness of Christ. Amen? The moment you bow your knee to the power of Jesus' forgiveness, your past is emptied of its ability to manage your future. Now, you might say, well, Pastor, you know, why is that? I mean, I still feel like it's alive and well. Why is that? Now, listen, here's what you need to get today. To answer the question of why is the forgiveness of Christ so powerful, you have to understand the totality and the depth and the breadth of his forgiveness. Now listen, we have a hard time with this because we are very familiar with human forgiveness. I want you to give yourself a big pat on the back today. How many of you have ever forgiven somebody that's done something wrong to you? Anybody out there ever forgiven? That's a good thing, man. That's a good thing. The problem, though, is this. Our human forgiveness, listen, it has limits. And it has limits because we have limits. And listen, if you were to do something to me, if you were to hurt me in some way, I would forgive you, but my human nature then does something, and I don't even realize it's happening, but it happens. I then categorize you. I might forgive you, but now you're on the list of someone that has hurt me. And because I have categorized you, I now have a hard time seeing you without seeing what you did to me. So in a sense, human forgiveness, it's good, but it's not deep enough. It doesn't go far enough. We forgive, but our forgiveness is not complete enough to restore future relationship. Now let me just illustrate that. Imagine you worked here on the church staff and you just really did something to hurt the church and hurt me and what have you. And then eventually you leave. Now we forgive you, I forgive you, but then a month later you come back and you say, hey, if you've forgiven me, then give me my job back. How many of you think I might have a hard time with that? Why is that? Because I've forgiven you, but the problem is my human nature has now categorized you, right? I might say, well, you're forgiven, but as far as having future relationship and things just being okay, well, that's just, you know, I mean, because I'm a human being, and listen, I can't forget. And even we even say it like this, even wisdom would say, I've learned my lesson. That's human forgiveness. Doesn't sound all that great, does it? That type of forgiveness is not far enough. No, the type of forgiveness I'm talking about when we talk about our great God, it requires divine power because that forgiveness requires something impossible in human terms. Now listen, I want you to get this, it's so big. The forgiveness of God initiates the forgetfulness of God. The forgiveness of God, it initiates the forgetfulness of God. I might be able to forgive, but in my human ability, I cannot, without God's help, forget. Now, what a strange statement that is. Well, first off, because I forgive, but I can't forget, so we have a hard time associating with that. And secondly, how can a God who is all-powerful and all-knowing, how can that God ever forget anything? How many of you know God knows everything? Amen? So how can God ever forget anything? Does God suddenly get dementia, you know, or something like that? I mean, is he just some old God that forgets stuff? No, that's not it at all. No, he is all powerful. He is perfectly strong. And yet he forgets anyway. Why? Well, simply put, he chooses to do so. And this is all throughout the Word of God. In Hebrews 8, verse 12, and chapter 10, verse 17, the Bible tells us that when God forgives our sin, he remembers them no more. Everybody say no more. He remembers them no more. Micah 7:19 tells us that when God forgives us, he casts our sins into the depths of the sea. Your version of your Bible might say he throws the sin into the sea of forgetfulness. God literally has a sea of forgetfulness that is designed to catch all of the sin he has forgiven you of. I like Psalm 133, verse 12. It says this, he has removed our sins as far as the what? The east is from the west. In the Message Bible, it says, as far as the sunrise is from the sunset, he has separated us from our sins. How many of you know, if you go east, you ain't going west, right? East and west, the two shall never, ever meet. And the Bible says that when God forgives our sin, he casts them away from himself in such a fashion that it will never, ever come back around. I love Isaiah 43, verse 25. The Bible says, I wipe away your sin. Now look at this. Because of who I am. It's not because of you. It's because of who he is. And so, look, I will forget the wrongs you have done. Now, I love this in the New Living Translation. God says this. He said, I alone will blot out your sins. Now look at that phrase. For whose sake? For my sake. For my sake, and I will never remember them again. Now, that phrase, for my sake, it implies this, that God decides within himself that he will never think of your sins ever again. Now, be honest. Somebody that has really significantly hurt you, you might get to the point where you can forgive them, but how many of you know, from time to time, you think about what they did? From time to time, it comes almost involuntarily into your mind, into your subconscious, and you go over it again. The Bible says that God never does that. Now, why does he employ such discipline? Why would God work so hard to not remember the things we've done? He might even want to remind himself of how great his forgiveness is, and yet he doesn't do that. Why? Well, the Bible tells us clearly that he does not do that for us because we're forgiven either way, amen? He does that for himself. God employs his forgetfulness when it comes to your forgiven sin, not for you, but for himself. Now listen, I just think this is an amazing trait of the character of God. God knows he forgave you, but he has forgotten what he forgave you of. God knows that you have been forgiven because he sees you through the blood of Jesus, but he has completely forgotten what it is that you were forgiven of. Now, this is crazy to me. Why would God do such a thing? And here's why. See, God intentionally refuses to remember who you were so that he can fully focus on who you're going to be. God does not want the image of the old you clouding the image of the new you. So he remembers the old you no more. Now again, when we compare this to the forgiveness that we human beings offer, we have a hard time with this. Why? Well, because on a human scale, this type of forgiveness is emotionally impossible. Imagine if you were in a wonderful, loving marriage, and then one day you come home and you open up your computer and you find some emails you shouldn't have found. And all of a sudden, you start realizing that, hey, my spouse might not be faithful to me. And so you hire a private detective, and after a while, you've got video of your spouse cheating on you. I've counseled many people that have been through affairs, and often what they will say is this, every time I look at this person, I can't help but see her with him. Every time I look at you, all I see is what you did to me, right? How many of you know that's the truth? So our image, what we're saying is our image of what you did or what happened has stolen our imagination of what could be. Our past has literally stolen our future. Now here's what you got to get about God. God does not have this problem. Because when God forgives, he casts the sin into the sea of forgetfulness. Now, why does he do that? He doesn't do it so that you can feel better about it and just know that he doesn't remember it. No, he does that on behalf of himself. so that every time he reestablishes his relationship with you, my friend, the marriage is back on. The job is back in your life, right? God restores. Why? Because he has forgotten what you were forgiven of. Wow, what a powerful thought. Let's just give a good hand to our great God. Now, if we're going to apply this final value, we have to have that same discipline ourselves. The way God disciplines himself when it comes to forgetfulness, we need to begin to discipline ourselves. Now listen, we have to stop reminding God of what we have done and start worshiping God for what he has done. Now listen, the next time you go to God and you say, I am so unworthy because you know what I did, can you just get this? He doesn't know what you did. Amen? I counseled somebody the other day and I said, how many times have you asked for forgiveness for this sin? They said at least 25, 30, maybe 50. And I said, well, do you know that for about 49 times you have been reminding God of something that he knows not what you're talking about? Amen? Because when he forgives, he forgets. Now listen, you have absolutely no right. You have no right to not forgive yourself. Here's why. When you don't forgive you, you're saying that somehow you are better than God himself. You are actually causing an affront to the very gospel of Jesus himself. You're saying, I know you died on the cross, I know you rose from the dead, and I know that's good with you, but with me, I still need a little more. How many of you know that's not right? Amen? We have to forgive ourselves. If he can forget what you have done, then you can forgive what you have done. And you can offer that same grace to everybody else. By God's help, how many of you know that we can forgive, but we can also begin to employ the forgetfulness of God. God can restore it so real that that marriage can be a marriage again. God can restore it so real that that friendship can actually be friendship again, if only we would turn to his forgiveness. Now, if it's possible, this value does something even bigger than proclaiming the forgiveness of Christ. This value actually proclaims the transformation offered by Christ. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 5:17 that therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new what? He's a new creation. The new creation has come, and the old is gone, and the new is here. Let's read it in another version. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. I was driving on Tuesday. I want to thank all of you for praying for my dad. My dad had a heart episode this weekend and has had a defibrillator machine placed in his chest, and God really saved his life, and I appreciate your prayers. But on Tuesday, I drove to Illinois, and I was just with him for a few hours, then drove back, so 8 hours in the car. And on the way back, I got pretty bored, and I started searching for something on the radio, and I came across, I don't know what station it was, but some Christian radio station. And there was a fella doing a talk on church history, and I thought, well, this will be good, man. I'll listen. He actually had a lot of good things to say. But then he began to harp on and attack what he sees as a phenomenon in the last 200 years of church history. He actually traced it all the way back to the great evangelist Charles Finney. And he says, this is the guy who started this. The need in the church for us to ask people to make intentional decisions to follow Christ. You might call it an altar call. Somebody bowing their head and saying, raise your hand, pray this prayer with me, choose Christ today. He was saying that he feels like, and it's only really been in church history for the last couple hundred of years. And so he spoke about how transformational moments are actually how a few people come to Christ, but most people come to Christ in a slow, gradual kind of growth into faith type experience. And he kept saying from his background, and I could tell that his background was very conservative, that that's the way it should be. And I sat in my car, and I mean, be honest with you, I just don't care too much usually about stuff like that, But I found myself saying out loud to this very educated man who could not hear me that I could not disagree more. Here's why. Because church history is littered with sudden moments of transformation. It's everywhere in the Bible. It's everywhere in the New Testament. And it's everywhere in church history. And in fact, I will take it even a step further and I will say this. If you have not had a transformational experience with Jesus, then you need to not stop. You need to not stop answering altar calls. You need to answer even more. You need to pray until you get it. Amen? You need to pray until there is a transformational moment with Christ. Listen, there is no such thing as a non-transformational salvation. Pastor, I accepted Christ and I'm good and I'm on my way to heaven and absolutely nothing has changed. Then I would say we need to pray again. We need to ask God by faith to transform your mind, your heart, your spirit, to break your sinful habits and to give you a new image in Christ Jesus. In fact, I would tell you this, if you have not had a transformational moment with Christ, then I very much question whether or not you are with Christ. Now, the good news is, how many of you know we have a loving God? Amen? We have a loving God. Can I just tell you this? Listen, God does not do remodels. Anybody ever remodel their house? You know, like I got to remodel my kitchen, you know, or whatever. Listen, God does not do remodels. God always makes everything new. Amen? That's what I love about our God. He is not resource poor. That's why we remodel, right? Because we don't have the resources to build it new. God always guts the place, amen? And he makes everything absolutely new. We have a transformational God. Now listen, we grow after salvation, but there is always, always to begin the journey, a sudden transformational moment, and that is available to you today. You might say, well, Pastor, where is that in the Bible? Well, it's all throughout the Bible, but especially in the story of the early church. Probably the greatest example we have in Acts is the story of the Apostle Paul. The Bible tells us that Paul is so much against the gospel that he is actually killing other Christians. He actually is hunting them down, leading raid parties, and if he found out that you were a Christian, at the time, Saul would have you killed. And the Bible tells us that one day on a place called the Damascus Road, he has a sudden transformational salvation experience. This guy not only becomes a Christian, but he becomes the greatest leader in the history of the church. He actually is used by the Holy Spirit to write 2/3 of the New Testament. His salvation was both transformative, it was sudden, and it was also progressive. It kept going. Paul himself would be baptized with the Holy Spirit and inspired by the Holy Spirit. He would write this. I love this verse. Philippians 3, verse 12 says, I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things or that I have already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection. Everybody say perfection. I mean, you know, when Christ possesses you, it's perfection for which Christ has possessed me. Now, I love this next verse. No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it yet, but I focus. I am bringing all my energies to bear on this one thing. Forgetting the what? The past. Paul knew he had a past. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. Now, I love that phrase, pressing into the future. Paul was always pressing towards what God had for them. See, who you were, it always wants more. Who I used to be, it always wants control of me. And that's never going to change until we enter into the presence of Jesus. But it doesn't mean that that old part that keeps trying to crawl out of the coffin, that it was not crucified with Christ. No, there is transformation at salvation. It's a little bit like this. I want you to imagine this. We're in a time right now as a country where we are trying to vote a new person into office. And I, at least in my lifetime, I've never seen such interest in an election this far out. And we have some candidates now that nobody would have ever imagined that they would have a chance, and yet they do. The people are imagining a different future. And we, in about a year or so, are going to be given the authority as the voting people to choose a different future. Now, I want you to imagine this. Imagine that we vote in a new president, and we will. And then on January 20th, 2017, our current president, Barack Obama, refuses to leave office. He just might do that. No, I'm just kidding. He refuses to leave office. I can promise you the guy has some stinking power right now. Amen? I mean, you believe that. He's got some power right now. But on January 20th, 2017, he will be stripped of his power. And it doesn't matter who he was. Amen? Doesn't matter that we forever will call him President Obama. He ain't president anymore after that. And whether he likes it or not, he will be removed from office. Now listen, what's happened with so many of us is we have voted for Christ. Amen? But the former administration, your past, it wants to hold on to its power. In Christ, there has been victory, but the loser won't leave. You have to force your past out of office. I mean, you know that's true. And this is a decent analogy of what happened to each of us when we were transformed by Jesus. An election has occurred, and we voted for Jesus, and now we have the authority by the winning of that vote. Listen, we have the authority to say, no longer, past, do you have control. But now Christ is in control of my future. That word authority, the root word of that word is the word author. Everybody say author. Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, it says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, who is the what? Author and perfecter of our faith. Now I want you to imagine with me something. I want you to imagine that I write an imaginary book about Pastor Duro. Now, I admire Pastor Duro. He's a good-looking guy, not quite as good-looking as me, but he's getting there, and he's maturing. Now, here's the thing. Because I am the author, I can do anything I want with Pastor Durrell. I can. I can make him rich. I could make you feel like what it feels like to be a white guy for a while, man. Ain't as easy as it looks, buddy. It's not, I'm telling you. You got to be friends with somebody to say that. The thing is, I could do anything I wanted to in the book. I could make him a foot taller, foot shorter, you know, whatever. Here's the thing. I might be the author, but here's the problem. I don't have any power to back up what I wrote. I could make Duro a billionaire, which I would like just to tithe on that. That'd be great. But the problem is I don't have $1 billion to make it come true. Now listen, here's what you got to know about your God. When the author Christ took over the authority in your life, he began writing your story. I mean, you know, he took the pen out of the past. Amen? And he started writing your story. But here's what you got to know about this author. He has the authority to back up every word that he writes. So when God places that crazy dream in your heart and you say, I don't know how it's going to happen, understand this, you're not the author. He is. Amen? So here's your key question of the day. Who has the authority to write the next chapter in your life? If you're going to walk under the authority of Jesus, you need to point your life in the direction of Christ. You got to walk away from your past into your future. Now, a simple truth is just this, and I know it's going to sound so basic, but you cannot go forward and backward at the same time. Try that in your car today and just let me know how it goes. Your transmission will be laying on the ground before you're done, right? Because you cannot go forward and backward at the same time. See, a shift in direction always requires or causes a change in destination. You're either walking in the direction of who you are in Christ, or you're walking in the direction of who you used to be outside of Christ. And your daily choices either move you towards your future in Christ, or they move you towards your past outside of Christ. You can't go forward and backward at the same time. This is the constant admonition of Scripture. Enter into the fullness of what Christ has done. Walk in a new direction. I love this verse, Ephesians 5:8. Says, once, everybody say once. Once you were full of darkness. How many of you know that's true? Amen? Amen. Once you were full of darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. So listen, live as people of the light. What's the Scripture telling us? You got to live differently. I can remember a story in the New Testament. It's found in John chapter 8. And what an incredible story it is. I've preached on it many times. It's a story about a lady who was literally caught in the act of adultery. Now, you can just imagine in their culture, you know, the small little homes they lived in and what have you, but somehow the Pharisees, the religious people of their day, walking down the street of her town, somebody peeked in the window, and there she is, doing the deed, committing adultery right there, caught in the act. The Bible says they literally drug her out of the house naked. Now, can you imagine that? Now, in our culture, of course, probably wouldn't happen, but in their culture, they were allowed to do this. And they drug her through the streets. Imagine the shame. And they bring her into the temple where Christ is teaching. And the Bible says they throw this naked, shame, caught on videotape, guilty lady in front of Christ. And they think they got him because they say this. They say, Jesus, the law says she should be stoned to death. What do you say? Now, if he says, well, I say she's forgiven, then they're going to say, well, you don't believe in the law. And if he says, well, stone her to death, then his entire message of grace is undermined. So what is Christ going to do? They think they got him. And they don't care about the lady. How many of you know religion doesn't really care about people? And the Bible tells us that Jesus goes on his knee and he starts to write with his finger in the dirt. Now, there's been all kinds of conjecture as to what he wrote. Truth is, we don't know what he wrote. Here's what I personally believe. I think he wrote the names of all the girlfriends of the Pharisees. That's what I think. He's like, okay, I saw you at the hotel the other night, you know, and what have you. And then he stands up and he says this. He said, he who has no sin. Remember the story? Cast the first stone. And the Bible tells us one by one they walk away, and then it's just Jesus and the naked lady. And what's interesting about this is, it doesn't ever say she was covered up or anything like that. It's just all of her shame in Christ right there. And the Bible tells us in this moment, Jesus says, where are your accusers? And neither do I accuse you. And then what's the last line of the text? Go and what? Sin no more. Now listen, we love to celebrate the transformational forgiveness of Christ. In that moment, she was transformed. Amen? But Jesus said, now you've got to walk in another direction. Why? Because you can't go backwards and forwards at the same time. Here's where we live as a culture. We want Christ, and then we want to go get back in the bed with the person we're committing adultery with. And I can tell you, my friend, if that's the way you're living for Christ, you've got to reapproach your very salvation. You got to come back to a place where you say, God, you, if you really save me, there is a transformation that will take place. And I can go in a new direction. I want to just point out two more scriptures and I'm done. And I want to tell you a story at the end. As I was moving and studying this week, I came across two verses that I think are just game changers. They're Romans chapter 13. I encourage you to study these later. I think they're in your notes. Romans chapter 13, verse 12 and 14, it says, the night has gone and the day is almost here. With the night speaking of this current age, the day speaking of Christ's return. So let us fling away the works of darkness and put on the full armor of light. Now get this. Clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. And look at this phrase. Make no provision. Everybody say no provision. No provision. For the flesh in regard to its improper desires. Now here's what you got to understand. When you come to Christ, your spirit, man, your spirit is generated in Christ. All of us before Christ have a dead spirit, but it comes to life. It is regenerated when we come to Christ. But it doesn't mean that this fleshly body suddenly goes away. I mean, you know, that happens in heaven, right? In heaven, we will be given what the Bible calls a glorified body, and that means your body becomes like your spirit. How many of you can't wait for the day when your body wants to serve Jesus just as much as your spirit? Amen? That's heaven to me. If there's temptation in heaven, then I don't want to go. But in heaven, our bodies become like our spirit, so there is no temptation. But while we live on this earth, even though we are alive in Christ in our spirits, we still have a flesh that wants stuff. And how many of you would admit, my flesh wants stuff? Amen? You know, your spirit wants a bowl of ice cream. Your flesh wants the whole gallon. Amen? Your spirit wants a healthy marriage. Your flesh wants 10 girlfriends and a healthy marriage. That's a good recipe for getting killed, by the way, especially if you're married to who I am. She's little, but vicious, man. Now, I'm not much of a camper, but I do know this. When I go camping, I like to bring provisions. Anybody, when you go camping, you like to bring provisions? I go camping, I go to Walmart first. Amen? Because when you go camping, the level of provision you bring, to me, determines both the comfort and the length of the stay. And so I like to bring some food, something to start a fire, maybe a big tent, possibly 3 or 4 generators, a couple big screen TVs, maybe if you could fly in a king-size bed. I mean, that kind of thing. It really makes the camping experience just much, much better. Now here's the thing you got to understand. The Bible says make no provision. Everybody say no provision for your flesh. The problem is we make provision. We go to lands that are not our homeland. They're not where we're supposed to live. And then we make provisions for the flesh. Now, how do we do this? Well, we make room for people to be in our lives that, quite frankly, other than evangelism, should not be in our lives. I can tell you, listen, if you don't change your associations, if you're still drawn to the same people, well, then I question whether or not there's been a transformational salvation in your life. Because I'm drawn to people, that my deep fellowship are other people that love Jesus, amen? Now, I have friends that are sinners, I promise you. But my fellowship is with those who know Christ. How about a habit? How many of you know a habit requires provision? Let me tell you how to break that smoking habit. This is going to be deep. You might want to write this down, those of you that are smokers. Now, I'm not saying smoking will send you to hell, but it might send you to heaven faster. You know, so you gotta watch it. You'll catch that later. Here's how you quit smoking. Don't buy any cigarettes. That's it. That's all I got for you right there. Don't buy any more cigarettes. Why? Because you got to make provision for your flesh. Amen? The way you break a habit is to not make provision for that habit any longer. Here's what I want to be in Christ. I want to make my current reality so uncomfortable for who I used to be and incredibly comfortable for who I'm going to be. Amen? So you set up your life around that. That's a good moment to clap. Amen, right there. The less you provide for your past, the more you will hunger for your future. Now let's say our value again together. Our past does not define our future. Our music is going to begin to come right now, and I want to shift gears just a little bit. I want to close and minister on a different level, and those of you that maybe this has been a deep morning for you, I want you just to sit up, and I want you to get this. The trap of the past is not always something constructed around what we did. Sometimes it is constructed around what was done to us. I've been talking about how to live for Christ all morning long and how to walk away from your sinful life. But some of you, you're caught into a past that doesn't have anything to do with your sinful behavior, but it's got everything to do with what somebody or something or some situation did to you. And I can't close this morning without ministering to those that are maybe you're hurting from a past, and it has an icy grip on you. It just won't let go. This week in my research, I came across a story that I'm going to try to show a lot of deference to it because it's a tragic story. It's a story about a girl named Rebecca Thomas. If you Google her name, news articles will come up about her. I promise you can research it yourself. It's a story about a person who could not get past their past. Rebecca was standing in front of a convenience store in 1973 in Casper, Wyoming, a place I've been to many times. I've spoke there a lot. I did a lot for the Wyoming district back in the day. It's kind of a weird town. It's got a weird spirit to it. She's standing in front of a convenience store with her 11-year-old sister, Amy. And two evil men pulled up in front of the store. Somehow they got past whatever and they abducted Rebecca and Amy. They drove her 40 miles, her and her sister, outside of town, and they took her to a place called the Fremont Canyon Bridge. I don't think I've been on this bridge before, but I can picture it. It's a one-lane steel structure. It sits about 112 feet above the North Platte River, and there's a lot of just small mountain ranges there, and you can imagine it. And they drove her to the middle of this one-lane steel structure, a bridge probably not driven across 5 or 6 times a day. And in the middle of that bridge, they brutally raped Rebecca. They beat her. And somehow she convinced her attackers to not do the same to her 11-year-old sister. And somehow they didn't touch her sister until they did this. They grabbed the sister and they threw her over the bridge. She hit the ground and her head hit a rock and she broke her neck and she was killed instantly. And then they grabbed Rebecca, already beaten, already raped, and they threw her off the bridge. Now, she didn't hit quite right, and so she kind of careened off of the side of something, and then she ended up into the deep water of that river. She broke her hip in 5 places from the impact, and somehow, just miracle of all miracles, she crawled to the shore. She wedged herself between 2 rocks. The attackers didn't climb down to finish the job, and Rebecca shivered through the cold night, and she was found the next day. But she never left that canyon. She was rescued. Her physicians tended to her wounds, and off of her description, her captors were convicted by a court of law and they were put in jail. But her life was never the same. The sun never rose for Rebecca. Mentally and emotionally, she never left the canyon of her past. The darkness of what had been done to her never gave way to light, and she tried, but she could never climb out of that gorge. And so in September 1992, about 19 years later, she'd had a failed marriage. She had a little toddler daughter in the back, and she had her new boyfriend sitting next to her. And they were driving through town, and suddenly she put her foot on the gas and smashed it to the floor. Her boyfriend said, "What's going on?" And she said, "I'm going back." And she took off. And she headed towards the Fremont Canyon Bridge. She hadn't been there in 19 years, you can imagine. The more he pleaded, the faster she went. You know, that's the way some people are. You know, they can come to Christ, and the more you plead, the more they run back to who they used to be. Now listen, God is not going to force you to follow him no matter how deeply he transforms you. You got to walk in the direction of your salvation, amen? And the more he pleaded, and he did, she sped, sometimes 70, sometimes up to 100 miles an hour, towards the Fremont Canyon Bridge. Within just a few minutes, she was there. She went right to the middle of the bridge. She got out. She stood on the spot where she was raped, and with great emotion, she told the whole story to her boyfriend and, unfortunately, to her 2-year-old daughter, who he was holding. She was crying. She was weeping. She just couldn't get over it, and finally, the boyfriend, probably wisdom in that moment, said the daughter should not be hearing this, and he turned around to walk back to the car, and when he did, he heard Rebecca's body hit the bottom of the canyon. She died for a second time. The icy grip of her past just never let go, and she couldn't get past it. Now, I've never been raped. Been beat up a couple times, but not bad. Certainly have never been thrown off a bridge. Anybody here? I didn't think so. So we don't have any right to judge or care to judge Rebecca. How many of you know we serve a great God of great grace? Amen. But I will say this. There are canyons of the past in all of our lives. And sometimes the hurt and the sin, they're just kind of mixed together, and they get sticky, and it's hard to get out of them. And there's a gravitational pull to the past, isn't there? And it's always trying to pull us back. It's always trying to get us back down. And you have to understand this. Only Christ can truly pull you out of the past, because only Christ can truly heal the past. Amen? Now, I don't know if Rebecca ever turned to Christ, and maybe she did. Maybe she walked away from her salvation. I don't know. God never violates our free will. You got to understand that. It's the greatest gift he's ever given to every one of us, and you can walk away from your salvation. He'll chase you, but you can walk away. You can walk. No one can pluck you out of the Father's hand, but you can walk right out. And that's what Rebecca did if she had accepted Christ. I don't know if she had. Now, I will tell you this. I was a sophomore in Bible college, or no, I take that back. I would be 2 years into the ministry when Rebecca died. I didn't hear about the story, but it made the front page of all the newspapers in the country because it was such an odd situation. But if I had in that moment, if I had just a minute with Rebecca, I think I would have read her these two verses. I want you to close your eyes right where you're at, and I want to read them to you, and I want you to listen from your canyon. From the gorge of your past, I want you to listen right now. The Bible says this in Psalm 34. It says, the Lord hears his people when they call out for him, help. He rescues them from their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and he rescues those whose spirits are crushed. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and he rescues those whose spirits are crushed. Now, Father, right now, in Jesus' name, I pray over so many whose hearts are broken, their spirits are crushed, and I ask you that you would enter into the canyon of their past, and you would do what only you can do. You would make things new. You would create a new creature in Christ. I want you to receive this. I pray for those that have been abused. If the statistics hold true, about a third of this room have been abused sexually, physically, mentally, emotionally. I ask you, God, that you would go into those dark places. Just pray this under your breath. I invite you, Jesus. Go there with me. Today, you stand on the bridge. And you know what happened. And we can forever ask the question, why didn't you stop it? We live in a broken and sinful world. All I know is that you meet us right where we are. Come on, I want you to pray this. You can pray it, just whisper it where you are. I invite you into my canyon. Heal me. Get me out of this place. Restore me. In Jesus' name. What a great God we serve. Amen. Now listen, there is no past that is so dark that Jesus can't find you there. He can't bring light. The Bible says in him, there is no darkness at all. There's no darkness in Christ. I mean, you know, if we made this room as dark as it could possibly be, we taped up every window, just one small candle would cut the darkness, right? The darkness never wins over the light. The light always wins over the darkness. Amen? There is no darkness in Christ. Listen, that canyon, it might be deep, and that hurt, it might be profound. And yes, there might need to be follow-up meetings after this. But Jesus can rescue you from that canyon. That hurt, it might be so horrific, but Jesus can heal you. And more than that, he can use your story to heal other people. Amen? What if Rebecca had chosen that? And again, no judgment, but what if she had chosen that? What a story, what a testimony that our God could heal somebody and bring them out of a canyon of hurt like that. And we know he can. Amen? We know he can. And as far as what we've talked about for the bulk of this morning, there is no sin that is so great that Jesus can't forgive that sin. And note this, your past doesn't define your future because Jesus doesn't remember your past. Amen? That's the awesome thing about our God. When you are transformed in Christ, and that's why it's so important to have a transformational moment. A moment you can point to, a sudden that you can appoint to. And you can say, that's the moment, that's the day that I gave my heart to Christ. Now listen, not against slow growth. We're all growing. We're all being transformed into the image of Christ. But you got to have that moment when you vote the past out of office. And you coronate your king, Jesus, amen? And you say, from this point forward, I'm going to associate my past with the forgiveness of Christ, and I'm going to associate my future with the power of God to perform great things on my behalf. And that's what God wants to do for every one of us today. I'm going to have Pastor Andy come. Why don't you all stand to your feet, if you would, right where you are. I'll tell you what, as Andy's coming, let me just mention this. I'm going to have some of our prayer team. You guys can go ahead, and I want a couple of you up in the balcony and a few of you down front. After Pastor Andy closes with prayer, and the atmosphere of the room will change just a little bit, but there are some of you that you need to be prayed with individually this morning. And there's going to be folks that pray with me every Sunday. I go back and they pray with me every Sunday before I come out. They're going to be available at different spots throughout the building. And you can come down front. You can meet a couple of them up in the balcony areas. And somebody can pray with you. If you need somebody to hug your neck, you need somebody to counsel you just a little bit, then that's going to be available to you. Pastor Andy, would you come?
What a powerful word this morning. Yeah. I want to encourage you, if you're somebody that, as Pastor was saying with the prayer team, if you need somebody to pray with you, we want to be available to pray with you after the service. It often can take some processing and some prayer and some just really hearing the truth of God spoken over your life to take that step and really trust that God has taken away your past. I also want to encourage you that as you go through your week, one of the best things that you can do is begin to spend time with God. And we provide each and every week as a part of the note sheet, we provide what we call a study guide. And we take just some of the verses that Pastor uses in his messages, and we just give you focuses for you to pray through some of those things, that some of the verses that Pastor used about how he's removed our sin as far as from the east as from the west. Some of you, it would be good for you to just pause for a moment and say, God, help me understand. Help me have just a glimpse of what that means. Because God can apply that truth to your life. But I hope that if you need prayer today, that you'll come and you'll see one of our prayer team so that we can pray for you. We've got people available in the balcony and down front. But if not, I hope you have a great day, and we'll see you next week. Have a great day.